Thank you. I admire your stamina. Didn't think we'd have so many people at the end of the day, but the organizers asked me to talk about motives, and so I thought I would give a fairly relaxed... it's an awkward subject because it's a subject that Grothendieck was very interested in. If you look at his letters to Serre, for example, they come up frequently. But he never published anything, or at least to my knowledge, he never published anything about motives. And I suspect the reason was that you run up against some difficult conjectures that nobody... and in fact, I talked with Grothendieck once in my life. As he was leaving mathematics, I was coming in. But I did talk with him once, and I asked him precisely about what are called the standard conjectures, which are, so to speak, the obstruction to pushing through his program of what are called pure motives. And he told me that he had high hopes that they would be proved before he died. But it was not to be so. So what I thought I would do is give a fairly relaxed talk, and I want to kind of emphasize sort of the progress in motives. So the first is what you might call Grothendieck motives. Those are intimately linked to the Vey conjectures. I mean, I think it's fair to say that Grothendieck was inspired to develop the notion of motive by his attack on the Vey conjectures. Then, more or less after Grothendieck had left mathematics, the subject of mixed motives grew up. Primarily, Deligne certainly developed the notion of mixed Hodge structure, and Balanson. My memory is, and I could be wrong, but my memory is that it was Balanson who kind of ported Deligne's mixed Hodge structures to the theory of motives. So here, one of the important motivations was the Balanson, or were the Balanson conjectures. And in particular, you could argue that, I mean, you might think that it sort of replaced the Vey conjectures. Here, the conjectures concern values of Hasse Vey L functions. So, mixed motives, at least one of the primary reasons to develop such a theory is arithmetic. I mean, you'd like to understand these very arithmetic objects. And then the subject which has become kind of dear to my own heart has not been really developed very much, but I want to sort of say some words about it in any case, is the role of motives in physics. And here, there are two things to say, one of which is true. So certainly it is the case that Feynman amplitudes, which are the essential numbers that one needs for perturbative quantum field theory, Feynman amplitudes are periods of motives. And I have to explain what that means. The second thing, which very probably is not true, but that's all right. Probably I won't have time to explain it anyway, is that, how shall I say this? Let me just say, Tannakian theory of quantum field theories. Essentially, for I think it's fair to say for Grothendieck, one of the central ideas involved in studying motives is that they form a Tannakian category. The pure motives form a Tannakian category. And so we'll have to see a little bit what that means. And the question then here is, what happens if we try to apply the same kind of Tannakian calculus to the study of quantum field theories? And the answer is, I don't know, but there's at least a little bit one can say, and it's kind of amusing. So I hope I'll have time to say some words about that.
The stick is there.
Ah, well, that's sort of a little... Okay, so motives. Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of reminded, I taught undergraduate calculus for 40 years, and there were certain things that would always happen. And one thing that would always happen is that after the first lecture, some kid would come up to you and say, the first lecture I would always devote to sort of talking about numbers, I mean, real numbers, where we were going to do the calculus, the properties of real numbers. And some kid would come up and say, but professor, what is a number? And I never got a good answer to that. But the one thing I can say with statistical certainty is that that student was going to do very poorly in the course. So, I mean, it's in some sense the wrong question. Right? Math doesn't really tell you what a number is. It can tell you properties of numbers. So for example, it can tell you if you have 5 pairs of shoes, you will need 10 shoelaces. But it doesn't really tell you what a number is. So I think similarly, if we want to talk about an algebraic variety, you have this phenomenon that is kind of like, I mean, there's sort of two things, and they're close together, and I'm not enough of a philosopher to be able to say whether they're different or not. But one are the sort of manifestations of this mathematical object. And the other are the kind of interactions of this mathematical object with other mathematical objects. And these are two kind of things that we can hope to say concrete things about. And I think that's very much Grothendieck's approach. What do I want to say here? Well, the manifestations. So how to see an algebraic variety one way to see it, and I think, as I say, it was important because of the Vey conjectures, was to look at solutions to polynomial equations. Mm-hmm. So solutions to polynomial equations, everybody kind of knows how the game is played. If I have, for example, x squared plus 1 equals 0, there's a simple polynomial equation, I can say that this has no real solutions, of course, we know that. It has a solution because 2 squared plus 1 equals 5. It has a solution, so we get a solution mod 5. But on the other hand, there's no solution. No solution mod 3, right? So the Vey conjectures are that. They ask for how many solutions, or how many points in our variety with values in Fp, or more generally, Fp to the n. So I remind you that Fp is the simplest kind of a field. It's Z mod Pz, where P is prime. And Fp to the n, it happens, if you study the Galois theory of this field, that there is one extension of degree n, so Fp n over Fp is n. There's one for each n. And so we could ask to study the function which associates the n, the number of points in V Fp to the n. So that was the idea. Well, I actually don't want to get into the history, but certainly Vey studied this problem and others before him. But Vey came up with the basic intuition. And the basic intuition was that you have a Frobenius, so call it F. And it's a ring homomorphism from Fp to the n, or let's say more general. Well, it sends f of x is simply x to the p, and the fixed points. So Fp n f equals 1 is just Fp. Right? And more generally, the fixed points of Fp to the n. Well, the fixed points if n m, and if I look at f to the nth power, then this is fp to the m kind of thing. I hope I have that right. Something like that is true. And with that in mind, if I have a tuple, let's say x1, 2xn, oh, too many n's, x1 to x, what should I say, d, and I apply f to it, so this is x1 to the p, xd to the p, and so if this point, x1, xd, if this belongs to v of fp, then, or this will belong to V of Fp if and only if. So this will be true if and only if this point x1, xd, viewed as belonging to a point of the variety over the algebraic closure, is fixed under. And more generally, if I take f to the r, then I can put here p to the r and f to the r and get such a statement. So Vey's beautiful idea was that we could, using the topological construction of Lefschetz, that we could turn this into a problem of linear algebra. So the point was that if we have, let's say, capital F, an endomorphism of a vector space, then we can consider the generating series, the trace of F to the n, times t to the n. And with appropriate additional structure, so if we have a duality, if so, V is given as isomorphic to V dual, then we can work. So I don't want to get too much into it, but we can work in V tensor V dual and write the F and also the identity as sort of elements in V tensor V dual and do linear algebra in V tensor V dual. And this, Lefschetz observed, made sense in the, if we could talk about the topology. So in topology, we take, I'm being a little vague, V is the cohomology of some appropriate manifold with Poincaré duality. And then if F is a map from X to X, which has fixed points. So we're interested in the fixed points. We want to study the fixed points of F, various powers of F. And if we're fortunate that the fixed points are in good position, then we can study this by looking at the intersection of the graph of F to the n intersected with the diagonal. And lo and behold, this is exactly, in the topological context, the trace of F star to the nth power, where F star is the action on cohomology.
Or super trace.
Sorry?
Super trace, alternating
sum. Yeah, you have to, right, I'm cheating, I'm going too fast here. We really should take the alternating sum of these things. But people are familiar with these ideas. So the point is that with this mechanism, the intersection here, so in our case, because of the geometric fact that a point is fixed, if and only if it's fixed under the Frobenius, so in our case, we take our variety V and we view it as, or we view F as acting on V. You have to be a little careful. It's kind of confusing because Frobenius, you have to work with the relative Frobenius. But again, that's a technical point I don't want to get into. The intuition is that the fixed points of various powers of F exactly count. So the fixed points of F to the R are in one-to-one correspondence with the points in V F to the R. Okay? And granting that, one may hope to apply the Lefschetz machine to relate our counting problem. So our function, we want to understand our function which sends n to the number of points of V, F, P to the n. And we relate the generating series that we get from this problem to the sum of the trace of F star. So again, yeah, now I'm starting to cheat because as Vey observed, we don't have a good cohomology theory to apply. But if we could apply the thing, well, we do in fact now, but we didn't in those days. If we could apply the thing in the sense of Lefschetz to some nice cohomology theory, then we would exactly get and then we could go further, because of course we can write this as a product of, what is it, 1 over 1 minus alpha I t, right, where the alpha I's are the eigenvalues of f upper star. Okay, so they had developed this beautiful program, and he applied it in the case of curves, because in the case of curves, he could use the Jacobian and the points of finite order of the Jacobian to build an analog of the cohomology, and then he could apply his machine to that.
In your formula, it should be a sum instead of a product.
Sum.
No.
It's a trace, it's a sum.
No, it's not the determinant. It's determinant, yeah.
No.
Trace. Wow, okay.
No, this is
nice.
Yeah, you're right.
Well, it's a rational function. Would be a force.
So in other words, it's the sum, whatever it is, it's certainly the sum over I of the sum over n of alpha I to the n. T to the n, right. So it should be the sum, you're right.
Zeta function is different.
Once you're here, then all the other manipulations are just familiar combinatorial games. So anyway, this is where Groth and Deek started. And so he developed, the theory of Groth and Deek developed the theory of Ellenic cohomology. Which precisely gave us a theory on which we could compute these traces and prove at least part of the vague conjectures, and the history is kind of well known. The missing was still the vague conjectures also concerned the absolute values of the alpha I's, and that was kind of inaccessible because for problems that we'll see in a minute. But anyway, he developed this Ellenic cohomology, and the problem was that there were sort of too many of them. I mean, there's one of these cohomologies for every L. It was not the case, as in the classical topological picture, that you had a Q-valued cohomology. You had a QL valued cohomology, and it wasn't, in fact, I think it was Sayre who observed that you couldn't hope for a cohomology with values in Q, because you could construct, for example, elliptic curves over finite fields. So Q valued cohomology didn't exist because there existed elliptic curves. I think you want to take it over FP squared, whose endomorphisms were quaternion algebras. And so in particular, they had no, so this was a quaternion algebra, call it Q, quaternion, and it had no two-dimensional representations. And Groth and Deek knew, and it followed from Vey, that you wanted this representation in the case of an elliptic curve, it should be a two-dimensional vector space. So it had no two-dimensional representation, defined over Q. So you couldn't have Q cohomology, but you had this Ellenic cohomology. And so Groth and Deek asked himself, we should think of these Ellenic cohomologies as kind of manifestations of this abstract category of varieties. So he asked himself, well, can we think of these as like the smile on the Cheshire Cat in Alice in Wonderland? So the Cheshire cat has all these smiles that we can see, but we can't see the cat. So Grothendieck said, well, can we develop the abstract category, which he called the category of motives, which sort of underlay all these realizations. So we want the category of motives lying behind and the story is kind of well known. I mean, he had a beautiful program to do this, but the program was blocked because certain standard conjectures about algebraic cycles were turned out to be, first of all, necessary. These were needed. But to this day, no one can provable. No one can prove them. Unknown. Okay. But leaving aside the issue of actually proving it, he was left with a beautiful sort of picture of how things should be. And the picture revolved around this notion of Tannakian category. So let me... that wasn't cut high enough. So the category of motives was supposed to be so-called Tannakian category. And what did that mean? That meant that it was sort of abstractly equivalent. I'm speaking vaguely here because there are many issues, but it was sort of abstractly equivalent to the represent the category of representations of an algebraic group. How did that work? The idea was that this category, give it a name, call it Z, that there should be some functor, which he called a fiber functor, to the category of vector spaces, and the category should have a notion of tensor product, and the fiber functor should preserve the tensor product. And you should look at the automorphisms of the functor preserving the tensor product, and that should be the points of your algebraic group called G. So this should be G. I'm going very quickly. And then this was a sort of an extraordinary idea because suddenly the properties of the category can become translated into the properties of the group. And for Grothendieck, the group should be semi-simple. The category should be there should be no extensions. The presence, the elliptic phenomenon, that there were many different cohomology theories, the fiber functor should be, so a variety should be an object, should give rise to an object in here, or, well, I mean, there's some issues there with, but roughly speaking, a variety should give rise to an object, and the fiber functor should just be the cohomology of the variety, but of course we know that we have to take QL coefficients, and so in fact there are many fiber functors, but they're not defined over Q, they're defined over QL, and so suddenly there is a fascinating complication that this category is not actually a Tannakian category, not actually a neutral, there are various words that are used, but in any case, we have to extend the field, and for various field extensions, we get various fiber functors, and even p-adic fiber functors. And it's suddenly a very beautiful and very intricate picture. But this picture is blocked in the sense that because we can't prove these standard conjectures about the algebraic cycles, we can't actually prove this. There are issues. Okay, so now what I want to do is to talk next about the category of mixed motives. Because I think mathematics is kind of like a river, you know, and it flows. And every now and then there comes up a problem that nobody can solve. But the river, you know, so it's like a dam in the river. But the river, that water is coming at you, and it's got to go somewhere. And so if you're not careful, it just goes off a different direction. So I think inspired by Deligne's theory of mixed Hodge structures, Balanson, I hope I'm, probably other people were involved, but I say Balanson is sort of the main man, developed a theory of mixed motives. And so let me just explain a little bit why these are, what they are and why they're interesting. Well, I suppose I should start with the simple case. So growth index theory of Tannakian, I mean, growth index theory of motives was a semi-simple theory. There were no extensions. But if one looks around in real life, there are notions of extensions of motives. So let me just explain the simplest one. The simplest one is the so-called Kummer motives. And this is like this, that if I have, so I have my variety V, but now suppose that I have a unit. So I write OV star, so this means U is simply an invertible function. So it's a global unit. Then there are various games I can play with U. If my ground field, so if V is over K, and if K is inside C, then I can take the logarithm of U. And that's, of course, only well-defined up to 2 pi I, or up to z times 2 pi I. So Grothendieck would say that the set of logarithms is a torsor under the group z times 2 pi I. More algebraically, we could take the L to the nth root of U, and the collection of these guys is well-defined up to the L to the nth roots of unity. So this is the set of zeta in the algebraic closure, such that zeta L to the n is 1. And again, it's a torsor. So these are torsors. And if we, it's sort of a little bit more convenient to say things slightly differently. If we look at the set of pairs, log of U to the A, comma A, for A an integer, then the set of these pairs, well, it certainly augments off to the integers by sending this to A. And the kernel, well, the kernel is the set of choices of log here. So the kernel is just z times 2 pi I. And that's sort of a toy example of an extension. So this would be written as an extension of z or of z of 0 by z of 1. The so-called Kummer extension, or if you wanted to say it elliptically, I would have 0 goes to mu L to the n goes to the set of all pairs consisting of a UA 1 over L to the n, comma A, where now A wants to be an element in Z mod L to the n. So these, but these are not actually motives themselves. These are realizations. So these are realizations of a, quote, motive, which we haven't defined. And the motive is associated to the algebra-geometric object, which is the original unit U. Okay, so we've taken something like an algebraic variety, in this case not an algebraic variety, but an invertible function on an algebraic variety, and we've given the smile, or various smiles on the Cheshire cat, which we want to think of as being associated to a Cheshire cat, which is the... Okay, this all seems rather silly, but suddenly things are not so silly, because as a consequence of a theorem of Borel, we have something really extraordinary. There exists a motive, and I'll just state a very, very small, simple case of a great big theory, which looks like this, z of 3, m z of 0. So z of 3 means z of 1 tensor 3. So z of 1 is supposed to be a motive whose realizations include this one and these. And our category of motives is supposed to be a Tannakian category, which means we can take the tensor product. So whatever it is, this makes sense. And our category of motives, I didn't say it, but our category of mixed motives should be closed under extension. And so suddenly we have the possibility of looking at extensions. But the miracle, the extraordinary thing that happens is there exists one which yields as a period the Riemann zeta function. So this is the Riemann zeta function. At 3. So zeta of 3, which is a completely fascinating number. And now I have to explain to you what I mean by yields here. We have to, and it's instructive, so let's actually do that. So how do we get zeta of 3 from this abstract guy? Well, we have to look at one of the various smiles on the Cheshire cat. We have to look at what's called the Hodge realization. So I have to explain what that is. I would write it exactly the same way. So I'll write it the same way. But now I really have in mind that these are Hodge structures. So what do I mean by a Hodge structure? Well, this is just it's a free abelian group. It's Z. Well, actually,
Deline mixed structures. So
yeah, so mixed. Okay. So actually, let's look at this one. That's more instructive. So M as a Hodge structure means what? M of Z is a free abelian group. It's Z two times. But it has a little more structure. It has a weight filtration, M of Q. So I'll write M of Q as M of Z tensor Q. And similarly, M of C or M of R, same idea. So it has a weight filtration. And in this case, the weights are W minus 6 of M of Q is Z of 3 Q contained in M Q, which is just Q, but we don't worry. So this is M of Q is W 0. Q, so it has this increasing weight filtration. And it has a decreasing Hodge filtration. So, the Hodge filtration, this is actually the crucial point, is that the Hodge filtration is only defined once I tensor with C. Okay, and it's decreasing. And so what is it in this case? It's decreasing, so I have, in fact, I have 0 contained in F0 M of C, contained in, so it's decreasing, so if I write here F minus 3, that's bigger. It's confusing. M of C, which is the whole thing. M of C. Okay. And what's more, the category of these mixed Hodge structures is an abelian category, and the operation of taking the various filtration pieces is exact. So I then get 0 goes to F0 Z of 3C goes to F0 MC goes to F0 Z of 0. C goes to 0. Now, F0 of Z of 0 is everything. This is the filter Hodge filtration on the Z of I's is stupid. So this is just all, this is just literally C. In the sense that it actually has a distinguished element 1. On the other hand, Z of 3, this is F minus 3. And so F0, Z of 3, is actually 0. So in fact, this is an isomorphism. So in other words, this mysterious extension has a splitting, at least if I tensor with C. So I have, if I tensor with C, I have, call it S sub F, which is a canonical splitting. On the other hand, if I look at the original integral version, these are, after all, just free abelian groups, and so I can just choose a splitting. So I can take an S sub Z, which is defined over Z. Okay? And then the difference, so I can look at SF of 1 minus SZ of 1. And those are two elements that map to the same guy. And so the difference lies in here. So this lies in Z of 3, C. Now, it's not well defined, because even though the F splitting was canonical, the Z splitting is not. I just simply said there was one, but there's an ambiguity. So to make it canonical, I have to factor out by the Z of 3, Z, so to speak, the lattice. But this then is just, I haven't explained well, but when you think carefully about the situation here, what you're doing is you're factoring out by the lattice generated by 2 pi I cubed. So there is an invariant of the extension of Hodge structure. So what is the logic here? I said that Borel's work gives us an extension of motives. And then we take the Hodge realization of this extension of motives, and associated to this Hodge realization is an element in, so let's call this, we call it B for Borel, but we get the Hodge realization, so this is sort of, call it H of B, which is an element in here. But this is just, of course, it's R, direct sum R, I times R modulo Z times 2 pi cubed. Right? So if we ignore this part and just look at the real part, we find that from this extension of motives, we get a real number. And lo and behold, the real number that we get, so the image of this H of B in here is exactly zeta of 3. Okay, so that's just a quick sketch of the balancing conjectures, which are vastly more general and more inclusive. But unfortunately, the work of Borel only applies for number fields. So the balancing conjectures remain kind of like the standard conjectures, largely unproved. But we have many examples, and so there's considerable confidence that the picture is correct. Okay, so now let me segue in the remaining 15 minutes to the physical picture. What do I want to do here? So I suppose I should talk about, it hurts my heart, but I suppose I should talk about the aspect of the physical thing that I know is true, rather than the stuff that is probably nonsense, but I like. Let me talk a little bit, at least, about, this is physics. And I want to talk a little bit about Feynman. Basically, the game is going to be the same. Physics gives us, associated to, so this is, I should mention my collaborator, Pierre Van Hove, if we look at this graph, which somebody had the wit to describe as the two banana graph. In physics, Feynman's sort of program says that if we imagine incoming and outgoing particles, then what happens in the sort of the mysterious area where they collide is represented by various graphs, in this case just three lines. And so we have an incoming momentum and an outgoing momentum, and we write T for the Q squared, the Minkowski length of Q. And we have masses here, M1, M2, and M3. Then associated to the three edges with the masses, we have propagators. And we are led to try to compute a certain integral. So this leads to an integral, which is equal to some function, which let's call it, call it I, which is a function of t, of q squared. And also, of course, the masses. Just right there. Okay. Now, what is this function? It's a multiple valued function. So actually, the story is in two parts. The first part represents my work with Pierre. And that was the case, we looked at the case where the masses are all equal. M1 equals M2 equals M3 equals M. Okay. So in that case, what we got was an elliptic curve. So there was an E, which depended on T, which is an elliptic curve. And there was an extension. I should put a T here. It all depends on T. Think of T as fixed for a while.
And M doesn't occur.
What's the definition of the motive?
This is, M is my word for motive.
No, the small M.
The small M. Oh, yeah, it occurs. Actually, it doesn't. You're right. No. Yeah, no, it does not occur. Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point. You're right. So T is here replaced by, T is replaced by T over M, yeah. So there's no M. You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. Lo and behold, comes this extension, which we should think of as an extension of motives, right? But here, something's a little funny, because when I look at the weight filtration, on the Hodge realization, this fellow will have weight 3. 3, yeah. Minus 3, yeah. Minus. Weight minus 3. Whereas the two cases we looked at, we had weight minus 6, and the first case, the extension had weight minus 2. But here we have weight minus 3. But if we have a good theory of motives, we should be able to talk about this object not just as a hot structure, but actually as a motive, and we should have extension in this way. Okay, so suppose that, in any case, we have this extension of Hodge structures, and we can play the same game. We can look at the Hodge filtration, and the right Hodge filtration, we look at F0, So again, if we look at F0 of MTC, again, the same kind of discussion will show that it's isomorphic to F0 of Q of 0 C, which is just C. So again, we will have over, once we tensor with C, we will have, if we tensor with C here and here and here, then we will have an SF. And we will have an S, I prefer to talk over Q, so an SQ. Okay? So we will get SF minus SQ, which will give me an element in H1 of ETC modulo H1 of ETQ of 2. I mean, I have to, it's ambiguous again because the ambiguity of the choice of the rational section. Okay? Now, we want to get, I mean, physicists, you know, you try to explain Hodge theory and motives to them, they're a little skeptical. They want a function. So what we can do is we can pair, we have omega t, which is the holomorphic one form. So we can pair with omega t. And this gives us a complex number, not so well defined because I have to factor out, so modulo periods. Okay. So this is and that complex number, lo and behold, is I. So this is I of t. Okay, and actually, there's a lot more. I mean, we can tell you a lot about this I, and there are many interesting properties. But in any case, it's the first manifestation of these sort of more intricate kind of motives involving, well, for example, in this case, elliptic curves, with the physical amplitudes. And the I is the, roughly speaking, is an elliptic logarithm. Now, it's not the full story, sadly, because we assumed that m's, all the masses were equal. And in fact, that's the work that we did. But things are never constant in physics, and so line zero, and collaborators, Adams and Bogner, worked out the more general case. So the case of general masses. And when I saw their work, I told Pierre I was completely furious with myself because it's completely obvious. What you need to do. Namely, instead of taking an elliptic curve here, if we now insert general masses, what we are led to do is to take an open elliptic curve. So we have our elliptic curve, we still have our elliptic curve, but we now remove S, where S is a finite set of points. In fact, it's 6 points. Elliptic. Finite set, in fact 6 points, depending upon the masses. Okay, so we have a fixed elliptic curve. Once we fix the external momentum, we have a fixed elliptic curve, but if we vary the masses, then the set of 6 points varies. Okay, so what's the motivic? Why was I angry with myself? Well, because suddenly here we have a fascinating situation. This is no longer itself a pure motive. This is an open elliptic curve. So if you know a little bit about the situation, this fellow will be itself an extension of motives. And so, in fact, the M will be a sort of, they'll have three graded pieces. So the M, I'm out of time, but let me just say briefly, the MT will involve H1ET Q of 2. And it will also involve a direct sum, in fact, of 5 copies of Q of 1. And it will involve a Q of 0. Now, what kind of sense can we make out of such a triple, right? Well, this is supposed to be an abelian category and supposed to be representations of an algebraic group. So, the algebraic group in this case, because we're talking about, so just to finish up, we talk about representations. We talk about the Lie algebra, because in this case, the algebraic group is unipotent. So the Lie representation would look something like this. There'll be something here. There'll be something here. And there'll be something here. Okay. Now, essentially, when the dust settles, and I don't really have time to explain this in detail, the fellow here will be a point. So this fellow will actually be a point on the elliptic curve. So actually a point. Okay. This fellow here will be, so I'll give this point a name, call it, let's say, A. This fellow here will be the theta function applied to A. And this fellow here will be some algebraic cycle on ET cross affine 2 space, in fact, a curve. With certain properties. And with that data, we build a representation of a Lie algebra, which is the one that's associated to this mixed motive. So suddenly, physics is giving us an extremely interesting new object. I mean, it's not a surprise. I don't want to present this as some sort of miracle. Everybody knew these things were lurking there, but it's wonderful to see them arise, and particularly to arise in situations where physicists can actually calculate the amplitudes, and we can study them. So I think I'll stop here, but I hope I've shown that the mixed motives lead to a wonderful both arithmetic and physics applications. So I stop.
Questions?
So, the first number up there was the theta value. Uh-huh. In the elliptic curve case, do you also get an L value?
Yeah, this is part of the Balanchine conjectures. Yes, absolutely.
So it's the L value of what and at what?
Yeah, so, right. So the L value that would most naturally occur would be the L value of the Hasse-Wey L value of H1 of E. T. I guess I'm assuming that T is rational here, so that I can talk about arithmetic QL at the point S equals 2. So one step beyond the usual point you look at is S equals 1, where you get the period, but S equals 2.
Mm-hmm. You have this SF minus FSQ. Mm-hmm. It's a rank one flat bundle. Does it have a? Can you characterize it?
Sorry, rank one flat.
SF minus SQ. Yeah. It's an intermediate step here in the whole story. Yeah. It is in H1C divided by H1Q.
Ah, yeah. Can I tell you? Oh, can I tell you what the bundle is? It's an interesting. As I stand here, it's a kind of a. A nice story. I mean, you have to quantify what you mean by what is the bundle, you know, in what terms I could. Yeah, it's a flat bundle, but there are 17 of them, and I don't know how to describe which one. But there is a way to think about it from that point of view, I can say that. I'm not quite sure what the right question would be from that point of view, but yes, you can interpret that way, and one has a nice such theory, but which ones arise in this way, I don't know. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry.
You said that this is connected to this elliptic dialogue arithmetic.
Yeah, yeah. So if you expand the function, you have to think carefully to see that from this point of view. But if you actually expand out the number or the function, then you get the expansion of the elliptic dialogarithm, roughly speaking. I mean, it's
common. Again, the common belief some years ago that we should have only an ordinary dialogarithm, not elliptic one.
Yeah, well, you see here, not really, because here, part and parcel of the game is that we have external momenta,
yes.
Right? And the conjecture in physics concerned what they call vacuum graphs, where there was no external momentum. No, I think that one expected complexities, and this is simply.
But for vacuum graphs, we expect ordinary polynomials.
No, I mean that's a very deep business. That no one now knows that.
By according to Francis, he has examples of.
Yeah, Francis has the most interesting examples of ones that are not. Dialogues, yeah. Any other questions?
Okay, so thanks.